And if somebody asks you about it, then as or says, what a wonderful necklace or what great earrings, your answer should be, oh, thank you. I'm an artist. These are my designs and they are available, or unless they're not available. And then you have a card and you present that and so on. So did that take care of those questions? Okay. This is all jade. So jade comes in lots of colors, including red and white and green, lavender. This is lavender jade, which is my favorite and was my initial introduction to jade long before I started making jewelry. Look at this piece here, and where the arrow is pointing to a little apple that he's holding in his hand. And just think about that. This piece of jade is so well carved that the carver was able to highlight the apple or the piece where the apple was and make it a feature of this piece. It's amazing. This is very old jade, and these two pieces were probably belt ties or something on that order. You can tell that they're old, but look at how smooth this is. This is smooth because it's been worn for a long time and it's been handled a lot. This is not so old, and this is definitely not so old. This is imperial jade, which is a fabulous color. This is jade where the rings have are part of the original piece. And I have all these pieces because I love jade so much that I won't make jewelry out of it, because then somebody will talk me into selling it to them. So I don't want to sell my jade. So I, see the apple in his hand. That's just so beautiful. These are called passport masks. And these are used in Africa a while back. They're miniature masks, too small to be worn. They replicate the forms of masks worn in performance. Like their larger counterparts, they are powerful charms. They are so beautiful. And as a rule, they are made out of ivory or and sometimes bone. Just exquisite mask. Can't bring myself to move these into pieces either. And this is how I got started in jewelry in the first place. These are waist beads. All of these names are specific to what they are called in different parts of Africa, but waist beads are also worn in other countries as well. And so I was engaged to someone from Senegal, and I had the waist beads that you see here, still have them, around my neck to go out. No, I had them on a table. We were going out to dinner here, and he saw the necklace and the beads, and he said, you know how to wear those? And I thought that was the dumbest question I had ever heard. Of course I know how to wear beads. And so I didn't put them on then because they didn't go with the outfit. But the next time we were going to dinner, I put them on, and he looked at me and he said, why are you wearing those around your neck? And I said, well, they're beads. And he said, those are waist beads, or whatever the name was that he used. And he said, you should wear those around your waist and under your clothes. So I decided that I had time on my hands. I would make my own waist beads and surprise him. So I went to a bead store, and the artist that was there in Adams Morgan told me about the value of the old beads that I would be using, and said, these are old trade beads and they have value. And I was hooked. And I have been hooked on beads from that day to this. Now, I will tell you that the gentleman I was engaged to is long gone. but it doesn't matter because he came into my life to introduce me to beads, and I'm very grateful for that. So these are waist beads, and there's a story that says that they were used, they put them on little babies in order to gauge whether the child was growing appropriately. And if the beads filled out in an appropriate amount of time, then it was understood that the child was growing properly. But if not, then they would take it to the medicine man and ask for help because the baby was sick. As the child grew older and went into puberty, the mother would change the string that the beads were strung on for the girls. And the idea being that if the girl entered into any extracurricular activity that she wasn't supposed to, the beads would break, the family would be embarrassed, and everybody would know that she had not done what she was supposed to. When she gets older, as a young mother, her husband will give her gold beads to wear as waist beads for any occasion, especially the birth of a boy child or an anniversary or anything. And the women of old would take these gold beads and hold on to them as insurance in case anything happened to their husband or if they separated or something. It was her insurance to have some money to be able to go forward. So there's a whole story there.
And I wanted to add about waist beads, mm-hmm. Elaine. I don't know if you know Clara. She is a regular vendor on Veterans Plaza. She okay. sells the waist beads from West Africa. She's from there herself. And I think she's from Ghana or maybe somewhere else. But she sells them. She told me that they're also used, women will use them to kind of watch their weight.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
I'm not going to talk about that, okay? Because
she's tried to sell them to me. But there's so many interesting things about or related to them. I think you were fine wearing them around your neck because they are very pretty.
Well, you know, the irony of that was that when I went to a market and purchased my first 5 strands of beads, and I bought 5 because I have 5 children. Mm-hmm. And so that's always been a good number for me. So I bought 5 strands and I would wear them. Nobody told me that they were for waist, for wearing under your clothes. They just let me buy them as just, you know, ornaments to wear around you. So yes, I try to tell folks so they can know.
Mm-hmm.
This is South Africa's pre-cell phone method of communicating. So they would send messages and tell folks how they felt about them by making these little squares. And there are actual messages in these squares. I don't know what these messages are, but it could be, I love you, I'm never speaking to you again, you are the light of my life, or don't ever come near me, whatever. Now we use cell phones and text messages, but back in the day, they used these little seed bead designs. Now to get into the designing of jewelry, and that's what captures your attention. Is it the shape? Is it the color? All of these things matter, the size, the texture, all of these components individually or collectively are what makes a piece wonderful. And at the bottom, you see these colors across here. This is imitation sinew, and this is a material that I use often because it adds color. It doesn't detract from the beads, and it can give me a method of holding a piece together or just adding another element of design. But these are all important things. So you end, and remember that your seasons define the colors that you'll lend yourself toward. For instance, in the summer, they're going to be lighter colors. And you should always pick, or I find And I suggest that you only choose the colors you're going to work with on the materials you're going to work with in daylight. And I say that because there are vast differences depending upon the lighting that you have available to you as to what colors are going to show up under what circumstances. So if you use daylight, you're pretty safe on having true color for whatever you're designing. And I can tell you that I have designed some pieces where I thought, well, I could get by and find the next day that I have two different colors of green when I thought I had one color of green. So you always want to be mindful of that. You want to pay attention to the culture and customs where you are, because sometimes that has something to do with the colors you use and how you use them. So if you're designing for an overall market, it may not make any difference to you. But if you're designing for someplace in particular, you want to think about that. And by the way, if you're going to design a piece in green, just because it's green does not mean that all greens go together, because they don't. So keep that in mind. This is color as a, we're looking at each of the elements, and this is color. So these are pieces that are done with combinations of colors. And up here, you have red and orange, which and yellow, which I think is really cool. And then here we have gray and blue. And the rhythm piece is multicolored. So you just always want, and one of the elements that I talk about a lot is you always want to be consistent. So you don't design a piece with all of this blue, and then this one bead, because you ran out of the blue, is red. And then you say to me, and I can't tell you how many times I've heard this, well, I thought this would add an element of surprise if I put a red bead up there. No, it does not add an element of surprise. It's an element of crazy, okay? Your piece is blue. The red is not connected anywhere in this necklace. So you don't put an odd color in there because you ran out of the blue. Usually I finish the sentence for the person. Don't tell me you ran out of this. Well, how did you know that? It's really clear. It's obvious that you ran out of this, because otherwise, why would you put this there? So I have set necklaces aside for a year and a half until I could get back to the supplier that would have the bead I needed to finish it. I don't recommend that everybody do that, but I'm just saying you want to be careful that you put combinations of beads together properly, and don't substitute just anything because you ran out of something. Set it aside and wait till you can get the right one. Shape is another important factor. These are all various kinds of shapes that you can experience, and there are many, many more. They're magical. Shapes can often be added in, and they just make or break a piece. You want to be careful that you don't have sharp edges. And remember, as you're feeling your beads and preparing your piece, that because of the kind of fabric that clothing is, you don't want something made with a sharp edge that will cut fabric, cut clothing, or damage someone's attire. And these are pieces that show what you can do with shape. I love these pieces. These are some more of A. Styles beads. She was completing a major in fine arts at Bowie State when she apprenticed with me. And I love these shapes. And on this, in order to combine these pieces, I used purple sinew to connect these beads so that the color was the combining factor in putting the beads together, because you have to pay attention to all of that, every little detail. On this piece down here, another one of her pieces, I added the orange, which was just sinew wrapped around this and tied so that it wouldn't move. And this is rubber in here. I use a lot of rubber in my designs, but I use the imitation sinew to connect with the coloring in here. So while the rubber was purple, which connected with this, I added the orange here to connect with the piece, with the primary piece. And this piece over here is called Fire Dreams, and it's like the piece that you saw earlier, the Waterfall Dreams. It's the same pattern, but no two of them are alike. And the earrings are freeform silver. They're just fun to do.
Elaine, we had a question. How do you connect sinew? And do you use real sinew, or is it all imitation?
No, it's all imitation. No animal parts, promise.
Okay, I thought so. But how do you connect it, as someone is asking?
First of all, it's like a linen, it would remind you of a linen fiber. And so what I do to connect it is I just make a hole and run it through on a needle or something that'll take it through a wire. And I can knot it on either side of the connection and burn it off, like right in, wait a minute, in here. And in here, in each of these places, this is polymer clay, which was about a quarter of an inch thick. And what I did was drill a hole through the polymer clay and then attach the sinew, take the sinew through and knot it on either side and burn off the rest, the extra. It works perfectly. You have to be careful when you're burning it off that you don't burn the knot off. But as long as you don't do that, it melts. The sinew has a wax substance on it, and it will melt it down. And I promise you, it will last. I told you I've been designing jewelry for 35 plus years. Let me assure you that I had a client come in recently with 30 pieces that she had purchased from me over the years. And there were only two of her 30 some pieces that had to be restrung. All the rest were in perfect condition. And I may add that she wears her jewelry every day. She travels the world. She has a company that takes her all over the world. She travels and she wears it. And out of all that jewelry being worn all the time, there were only two pieces that needed to be restrung. Now, all of the silver needed to be repolished, let me add that, but nothing needed to be restrung. So I'm very careful about how I put pieces together so that they last, because I don't want them coming back to haunt me, you know? And I guarantee my work. So
you're getting all kinds of questions in the chat here, Elaine. Everybody is so fascinated. So what, Karen Brown, who actually works with artists since the Smithsonian Folklife Festival, I've known her for many years, she's wonderful. She's asking, what is imitation sinew made of?
Hold on. I just so happen to have some here.
Oh, great.
It's a if I had a memory, I would be a very dangerous woman. polypropylene is what it's made out of, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it comes in, well, let me get a strand, some that's open. it comes in spools. I carry small spools so that, like this, for sale.
Mm-hmm.
Imitation sinew can be broken apart. So the average strand, can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll also put it here. Let me see. Yeah. The average strand can split into three pieces.
Mm-hmm.
This is two pieces, so this isn't a whole strand, but it'll split. And any one strand or one segment of a strand or two or three is equally strong. And you can either pair it, you can make it as thick as you want or as thin as you want, depending upon the hole in the bead or what you're using it for. Next question.
Yeah, someone is asking, what is sinew? I mean, it's really like a ligament in the body of mm-hmm. an animal. And I imagine maybe people are still using it in jewelry making in some parts of the world. Do you
Not
know?
Not the place where I've been, but possibly.
No. Right. So, but in the back in the day, they used to use it, right?
Yeah.
Right. And that same person is asking, can you add a different color bead on purpose?
Yes. Oh, you can, but mm-hmm. you have to connect that bead. So when you add a different color bead, it has to connect to something. It can't just, unless it's black and white, it just can't be arbitrarily out there. It can't, and then you have to strategically place it so that it really pops the pattern. I've added a red bead. I don't have a picture of it in this particular presentation, but I've added a red bead and, you know what? I'll have it in the book. I've added a red bead to a black and white piece and it was magic, but it was black and white and one red bead, but the red bead was in the very center. And so here we go. You see the black and white? Can you see that?
Yeah, you're in thumbnail, so it's fairly small.
Okay.
But we can see a little bit.
If
you stop your share, but I don't know if you'll lose your place.
Okay.
We can wait till the end if you want to show it at the end, maybe.
I'll show it at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And what are the other questions?
Judith is asking, where do you get the sinew?
You can get it from me. I carry it in several different colors. And because otherwise, if you buy it from the manufacturer, you are going to get a small amount, like 3 or 4 yards, and that's it. And it doesn't come in all the different colors like that. But because they've been working with me for years, they will make small spools. Otherwise, you can buy large spools of it, but that's a lot more than you need if you're just starting out using this material. Imitation sinew will stretch, so you also have to factor that in when you're using it in a design. If you're using it as an accent point, it's not going to make any difference. Sometimes I will string wire and then put the sinew around it because it works like that. Okay?
Yeah.
Any more questions?
Okay. I think that's it for them. Karen Green is asking, where can the art of bead stringing be purchased? Do you have an online store? And we have it on your website.
Exactly. It's on my website. It's $32 plus shipping. So I think it's $36. I'm not sure, but it's on the website. Go to the store part and the books and it's there.
And the website is elainerobnetmore.com.
Right. Right.
And now another question from Doris. Can one use the sinew to restring or repair jewelry?
It depends on what you're restringing and what you're repairing. Yes, you can. The absolute answer is yes, But the secondary question point is, what are you restringing? Because it's not going to work with nothing is unilaterally going to work on everything. So you have to choose what is best for the material you're stringing. Repairing pieces, yes, you can use it to repair, but what are you repairing and does it go with it? Is my exact answer. On here, you have the texture of beads, which are just awesome. This is polymer clay, and it's the colors and the texture is just amazing. There isn't a piece I've done with polymer clay that folks don't ask me about a million times. This is glass that I picked up from a Turkish artist in Istanbul when I was there representing the Bead Society at a conference. These are the fig tree bark beads. They're called Nziza, and they are just amazing beads, but we made these in such great shapes and sizes. These are made with thread, and these were done in Rwanda, but you can find these beads being made in many places. These are stones, so they're various stone beads, natural stones, and I don't know what this is. These are pearls. That's right. These are pearls. But all of these can either be separate or put together. And by the way, there's no such thing as, at least in my world, there's no such thing as just putting anything on a string and calling it a necklace. Even the pieces that look like I did that, there is a pattern there and it is adhered to rigidly for it to look good when it's finished, because you have to have a pattern. These pieces here, this is fig tree bark. And this was a bead that came loose, and so I incorporated it and added chain. These are tomb beads that are called, I'm not going to remember what the,
They look like monk beads.
Yes, thank you. That's what they are. And down here, some brass beads and some glass and chain. I love chain. This is where these links are. That they're all carved from one piece of wood on each side. And I just love that. And by the way, this is imitation sinew up here. And up here, I used imitation sinew just because I wanted to add the color. There's red in these beads. So I added the red up here to pick up the red in the beads down here. And this was strung on imitation sinew that's twisted. This is rubber, and these are Nziza beads. No, sorry, these are leather beads, but they were done in Kigali, Rwanda. Now, this is really important. Beads have a pattern. And when you're stringing beads, you need to incorporate that pattern into your design, because it helps to create rhythm in your piece. If you look at these beads, they're darker down here than at the top, and they're darker here than at the top. So that's the pattern. So if I'm stringing these beads, I'm going to string this way and consider that something is here in the middle, and then this goes up the other side, so that I keep the bottom of the beads at the bottom. Now, you could do it in reverse, but what I'm saying is pay attention to that and factor it in however you choose to design it. The same is true here. These beads look random, and while they are random, when I'm laying these beads out, one, I'm measuring the size of these beads because they're man-made, so they're going to be varying sizes. And so I will put them in the order of their size and the order of the width of this band around them so that there's some uniformity on both sides. Now, I still may do an asymmetrical design, but I'm going to have the beads laid out so that there's some rhythm, some unity in how they're going to look when finished. These are all natural stones, and this is malachite and turquoise. And what you see is the matrix, the combination of the minerals and so on in the making of the stone before it's cut and shaped. And so it's dark down here and light at the top. I love these beads.
Yes, someone is asking, what are the orange beads? Are they carnitine, you said?
No, those are carnelian.
Carnelian, right. Mm-hmm. I know carnelian.
Actually, yes. I was wondering about the orange beads in the previous slide, if you don't mind.
Oh,
sorry.
These are recycled glass, probably out of Ghana.
Thank you.
Okay.
Beautiful. Thank you, Lisa.
Sure. Yeah, folks are, well, you're welcome to chime in and have a more natural discussion. Elaine doesn't mind if you ask a question.
Not at all.
She just can't see the chat when she's sharing her screen right. So easily.
These are carnelian. Now, this is how the strand came. This is what I did with the strand. Can you see that the darker beads are now at the bottom toward the primary pendant piece? That's so that this way it just is kind of hodgepodge. This way there's an order to it. I'm not suggesting that the order has to be darker at the bottom and lighter at the top, but there needs to be a pattern created by you when you're mm-hmm. putting them together. At least that's how I see it. And this is even a better example of the top and the bottom of a bead. I took these and put them so that this side and this side, which has the most orange in it, is facing each other. And then on this one, the yellow are facing each other, and then, and so on. So you see here the yellow and or the orange. So it's a thought out process. Otherwise, it'll look nice, but it won't look great. And that's the key. The key is to create patterns that make your work stand out and uniquely different from others. And you can see it again here. Look at the black and white stripe. These are resin beads from Brazil. And they're beautiful beads. And they're lightweight. That's the other thing. I work hard at keeping materials that are lightweight so that nobody is carrying around 10 pounds of anything on their neck all day long.
Right. And jewelry designer Sharon Neuwirth is asking, is it important to try to keep the thickness consistent? For example, in one of the previous slides, I think a couple slides ago, the gold piece is thinner than the beads?
Oh, that was used in this particular case for, wait a minute. Let's see if I can go back. You mean here. This was not a real design. This was to show how the beads line up. This was not done because this was how I was going to finish this piece. This is not finished. It's open at the back. It was just to show the order of the beads and the coloring, not for
right. The kind of transition, the gradation of the,
yes.
the shading. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It looks
if we're going to yeah. finish this as a finished piece, then I would have bridged this with something else in here. And then I would apply something gold up in here to connect with this piece. I'm very big on always connecting pieces with something else in the necklace. It's not going to just, it may look like it just stands there, but there will be something that pulls it in.
Thank you.
And a dear friend and wonderful doll artist, Camila Bryce Laporte, is asking, where do you get your clamp? I think she means clamps. Camila, you mean clamps?
The clasps.
Oh, clasps.
I get them all over, and sometimes I make them. But there's a woman out of, I think it's Arizona. Anyway, it's Kim Fox is her name, and she's on Etsy. And she makes beautiful, beautiful clasps that she designs and then has made. So I use hers. I buy them from Stars Beads. I have no problem with sharing any of my sources with folks because that just don't. There are a couple of things I won't tell you where I get them, but I'll tell you what it is that I won't tell you where I get it. So you still get answers. Stars has really nice clasps, and Atlantic Gems on 2nd Avenue in Silver Spring has nice ones. It depends upon what I'm looking for a clasp. Now, I will also take found objects and make clasps out of them. I'll show you. So this is, can you see that?
Beautiful.
It's a fish that's copper and a piece of sea glass. And I just made that a clasp because it'll work. So, or I'll take a piece of silver wire and twist it and make a toggle out of it. I'll take a button and make a clasp out of that. And then I'll take the sinew and wrap it around that button. The yellow piece that I called Starship Enterprise, that has a button for the clasp and the sinew wraps around it and is weighted by a button at the end. So there are many different ways that you can use a clasp. These beads right here are lucite, I think. Yeah, lucite. And they're done by a woman artist out of New York who does beautiful carving of beads. They're just wonderful. So I get the beads from anywhere and I get my clasp from wherever. And I have been doing this long enough that I have a huge array of stuff I can pull from. This is, this is how I lay out a pattern from time to time. There are different ways I do it, but for something like this, I'll lay all of the beads out and space them the way I think they should be spaced out here, like this and like this. And then and with imitation sinew, sometimes I'll tie knots in an alternating color so that I can pull that color in from the beads. And then you end up with a piece like this, you see? So in this particular case, I'm working on a towel. Sometimes I'm working on a bead board and sometimes I'm working on something else. There are pieces that I've done that was so big that I've had a huge board and then cut and then put a cloth over it, tape the cloth to the board and put the piece on there. And it's, you know, it just depends on what I'm doing. Again, these are Jackie Brazil pieces out of Brazil. And I just love the elements. And then I'll take chain and cut it so that I can use different pieces of the chain when I can't find the chain the way I want it. And in this case, this is amber. So this piece can be worn long or short. And again, this is polymer clay and turquoise and rubber. And that's the mother of pearl. And imitation sinew. Proof of whether you are an artist is how committed you are to being satisfied with the piece when the piece is not exactly what you know it should be. So if you're satisfied with it being mediocre, you're not a true artist. If you're paying attention to detail and working hard at it, I've taken pieces apart 15 times just to put this piece together because of this work in here takes days, not hours, but days. Usually it's a week to 2 weeks to put a piece like that together. I don't do it very often, but every now and then I'll do one of those. And it doesn't last a day or so. You have to visualize what you're shooting for, and then you have to see the magic in it. I can't stress, well, for me, it's magic. It's your passion that people buy. It isn't just the finished piece. It's your passion that they want. It's your love of your craft that encourages people to acquire it. And I can't stress, if you're designing because you want to make money, good luck with that. But if you're designing because you have a passion to create this piece that is just unreal, that's a different story. And there will be those who buy that piece. I can remember when I first started that I had learned some things because I'm self-taught. So I've never taken I took one formal class, which was a 3-hour workshop in someplace. And other than that, I've not taken a formal class ever. And so what was interesting was that somebody showed me a male artist showed me in Adams Morgan how to put beads together how to put a clasp on. And so I was doing a show one day and I said to him, why don't you come and show your pieces? Because he was really good. I said, come show your pieces and share your work and I'll set up a table. And he had to work another job. So I said, well, I'll set your pieces up here. I'll put my pieces here. At the time, I did not have signage. I didn't have cards and all of that. It was just starting. So I said, but I'll put these together and we'll see what happens. He was a very angry person. He felt the world had dealt him a bad hand and he was always angry. Nobody wanted to touch his work. It was very interesting. But my work, and I didn't designate whose was whose, but they would walk up and touch it and caress it, and his they would not touch. So I say that to you to say that it is that love that you put into your work. It is that passion that people can see in your work and feel and experience that causes them to want your work. So don't worry about the trends, worry about your commitment to your craft. Now we get into artist to entrepreneur. Do you really want to be an entrepreneur? What makes your work special? Do you like people? How many ways are there to sell your work? And how do you write a business plan? I'm only going to address a couple of these things. One, if you don't mind staying up half the night doing the work you need to do to get finished a project, you might want to be an entrepreneur. If you don't mind the time and the energy to do a good job, you might want to be an entrepreneur. What makes your work special is really, really important. How much attention do you pay to it? Are you copying other designs or are you creating your own? And if you are copying other designs, maybe you're an artisan. Maybe you want to work with an artist, but don't confuse the two. They're equally important, but they're very different. If you're simply copying patterns, your work is never going to be set apart and that different. But if you are creating patterns, if you are making your own designs, now that's a sign of an artist. And I have to tell you this story, the woman I told you that makes the beads out of New York, the lucite beads. She's a fabulous bead maker, but she has terrible social skills. And so we were both doing a show at a museum here in the area. And somebody came up to her and they said, "Oh my God, I love your beads. These are wonderful. How do you do this?" She says, "It's really a hell of a hard work to do these beads." And I thought, okay, that woman is not going to want to buy these beads after she hears you describe it as, it's hell to do these beads, is what she said. So you have to love working with people or have somebody else who loves working with people do it for you. Because her beads were stunning, but her people skills were seriously in jeopardy. And nowadays, because of what we are facing with this pandemic, you have to be prepared to do Zoom shows. You think that's easy, that's not easy. It's hard work. And I'll show you a little bit about that. These are clients, and your clients will come from everywhere. Young, seasoned celebrities, professionals, powerful, accomplished, local, national, international, conservative, cutting edge, adventurous, cultural, and so on. You can't imagine how important it is for you to finish what you do in such a way that it appeals to everybody. This picture was taken in Paris. This tiara, she requested that I make the tiara and make the necklace and put it and have a necklace attached to it so you could take the necklace off of it. And I said, "I've never done that before." And she said, "That's why I'm giving you a whole year to figure it out." I did. I figured it out and the necklace came off. That was a Tahitian black pearl in the front and 22 karat gold throughout the freshwater pearls. But the top part of that tiara came off and you can wear it as a necklace. And she's been married 15 years and sent me a note the other day that said, "My necklace is still as beautiful today as it was the day you made it." So, this is Soledad O'Brien. You guys, if you saw the movie Hotel Rwanda, this is the owner of that hotel today. He's a young woman and she owns that hotel in Rwanda. These are all different clients. Packaging is important. This is old packaging and see these are my tags that go with each piece of my jewelry. So they fit either over it or on it. And in the pieces that you saw, you did not see the tags because I have my tags made so that they just become part of the design and you can't see where the tags are. But you need a business card. And this was an old photo of old cards. This is the new card and this is the front of it. And this is a gift card. This is the front, this is the back. This is, and Rayshawn, who's on here with us, is who designed my cards for me. This is the business card, the front and the back. And they're beautiful in person. I don't have these lit up. And then the bag has the seal on it and tissue that goes with it. and this is the earring card. And these are the little tags. I don't put tags on my individual pieces that are permanent. I'm sorry, that are attached with the description of the piece. I use a lucite stand in front of the necklace or the piece when it's on display. And on the front side is the name of the piece. All of my jewelry has names. And on the back side is a description of what it is. And this is, again, this was old packaging, but this was how I used to package these bags I have made overseas in Rwanda. And this is generally a card that just, this was a Happy New Year. So I take my jewelry, create a poem or a verse, and overlap the two for cards and so on. Photographs are important. I use a light box that's huge, but it's perfect and I can shoot photos in it. And I shoot my pictures now with my cell phone, with my iPhone, but it takes great pictures because it automatically lights it the way it needs to be lit. These are my daughter's jewelry. My daughter in San Francisco is a designer. She does aluminum and lots of fantastic earrings. These are some of those who wear my jewelry. And this one, oh wait, where is that thing? This is my daughter that's in San Francisco who makes fabulous earrings. This is a friend of mine in New York who made that necklace she's wearing. She's awesome. This is one of my students in Nigeria in, I can't think of the name of the town. She made this necklace after a workshop she took with me. It's fabulous. A friend and a fellow designer. This is in Lagos. This is a client and a student. And this was at the Walters Art Museum during a fashion show. This was one of my pieces that sold 5 minutes after the fashion show was over. And there were a line of people to get that one piece. And again, you wear your work. This is how you set up a show for a studio, for a home show, when you can do home shows. And you take whatever available surfaces there are and you decorate it nicely. Flowers, if they're available, but definitely white cloth because it will show up when you don't have additional lighting. I carry lights with me, spotlights that work to highlight tables and so on, so that I never depend on other folks, except in some instances when I know how much lighting they have, I will do it that way. And again, these are home shows. And this is my friend's setup in her home in Harlem. And we usually, before the pandemic, would do a group show at her place. And so you take these were surfaces that she created to show off her necklaces because that was necessary. And so you just show it off the best way that you can. But again, light backgrounds and lighting, if you can possibly do it. These are gallery shows. This, I don't know where the, oh, here it is. This is a gallery show. I love the pedestals. This is at the Kennedy Center. I've done several shows there, and this is at the Kennedy Center. So, but I carry my spotlights even when I do the show at the Kennedy Center. And this is not my work. This is sort of what you don't want it to look like because this is too busy and it's not specific enough. These stands I use because they are see-through. They're frosted, not clear, because that lets light flow through. And because a lot of my pieces have designs on the back, it's important that they be able to see through it. Again, these are more shows. This is at our bead bazaar. This is in California. This is at the American Craft Council show. So you have to just set up where you are and figure out what's going to best show off your work. Ten Commandments for Artists. Design with passion and love. Be original in your designs. Pay attention to the details. Choose or make a clasp that complements the jewelry you are making. Be the best at finishing your pieces. Pay attention to style and color trends, but stay true to yourself. Design for love, not for money. The more original and finished your work, the better. Keep your word, honor your promises, resist the temptation to copy. The best on keeping your word, because I sometimes do jewelry for weddings and for special occasions, I never miss a deadline. And at one point when a member of my family was very ill and I knew that I was going to be attending a funeral in the next week or 10 days, I finished a woman's wedding jewelry early because I knew I would not be able to focus on that when the person passed. And so she never knew that there was that problem. But keep in mind that no matter how much people care about us, we are still artists. And if we fail to meet their deadline, all they know is that we disappointed their particular day and their theme, and they didn't have what we promised. So we have to deliver. And I'm very adamant about that. And if you're an artisan, these commandments are for you. Pay attention to the pattern that you're following. Pay attention to the details. If you see a problem in the pattern that will keep it from working well, let somebody know so they can fix it. Be the best at finishing your pieces and on and on. This is work I've done in Lagos. These are students I had there. And this is, I love this. This is in several, Calabar. Oh, that's where the woman was with the necklace from Calabar. And Joss, and what was really interesting was in Joss, I was supposed to go back, and I did go back to Nigeria, but I couldn't go to Joss because they had unrest going on at the time. And so one of the artists in Joss who knew me called and said, listen, our mayor has scheduled a day in honor of you, and we're all prepared for you. And the first lady has even ordered extra security guards for your safety. And I thought, and that would be why I can't go to Joss. But sometimes we would have sessions in the oddest places. It didn't matter. They were really, really good at what they did. And it was a joy and an honor to work with them. This is up in Barbados, or down in Barbados, and this is in Malaysia. And these are the security guards that I had to have with me to go into Calabar, Nigeria, back when I did that. Those are machine guns in their hands. I didn't worry about that. Do what you love, and there will be those who love what you do. And that's the end of that presentation. Are there more questions?
Wonderful. That was just so fascinating.
Unmute ourselves.
I think we do have a lot of questions, and people are welcome to join in with your questions.
Hi, Lisa, this is Denise. I just wanted to let everyone know that I've put some URLs in the websites in the chat for the class when we were having that discussion. So if they look back in the chat, you can find those links.
Thank you so much. And folks can save the chat if you don't know how. You can, you just click the little three dots down in the chat and then save chat, and then you'll have everything.
Let me say this, that Denise apprentices with me and I mentor her, and she is a phenomenal artist, as is Rayshawn. The two of them keep me sane some of the time. The rest of the time, they just let me be crazy. but they are phenomenal artists in their own rights, and it is a joy. And actually, Denise makes a lot of the polymer clay that I use now. I didn't have any of the pieces in this particular presentation because this is an older presentation, but her work is stunning. So,
great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's see, we still have people coming in even.
Elaine, I have a question. This is Regina.
Uh-huh.
Elaine, when you are designing and you are making a piece, do you go by, you stay true to yourself as an artist, but if somebody wants a particular thing, do you design it for them or do you use the creativity that you use in your designing?
That's a good question, Regina. Regina is a student of mine. I do make custom pieces for people, just as the bride who said, I want a tiara with the necklace that comes off. But you have to give me a range and then you have to leave it alone. And my rule is simple. I will, if you have a particular dress that you want a necklace for or some earrings or something, then I will create what I think will complement that based on colors that you've given me and or a general style. But I will not take specific beads that you have and make a specific style that you design. That's not what I do. I will, and my rule is simple. When I finish the pieces, then if you like it, good, you can purchase it. And if you don't like it, I'm okay with that because somebody else will. I'm really all right with that, but I don't do the custom work where somebody says, well, I want this bead put here, and then I want you to put these beads. No, I don't do that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. We have time for a couple more questions.
One of them is they wanted Elaine to show the red and black necklace from the book.
Oh, okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Can you see it?
Mm-hmm.
It's the red bead is the only red bead on there, but it's positioned in such a way that it's a perfect complement for the black and white. Do you see? So it looks like a butterfly pattern with the two silver wings on it. Do you see? So Therefore you can take one color, one bead of one color and add it into a piece, but the pattern has to support that bead. And in this particular case, the pattern supported the bead by virtue of how the rest of the design was laid out. So it's only one bead of one color, but it works. I will mention if there's, I will tell you also how I initially got into the Smithsonian, because I think that's a really funny story. When I first started making jewelry, not maybe 4 months into making jewelry, folks were saying, because I started with making the waist beads and then I got bored with straight lines. And folks said, well, you should make necklaces. And so I attempted some and folks said, oh, you're an artist. And I said, I beg your pardon, I'm a businesswoman, not an artist. And I have no intentions of being an artist. You should know that my background was that I owned my own real estate company, built a housing complex back in the city of East St. Louis many, many years ago, and owned my own travel agency. So, and did business consulting, but art was far away from my thinking of it as a business. So I finally put some pieces together and folks would say, well, have you thought about going to the Smithsonian? Mind you, I was only 4 months into designing jewelry. And I said, I don't know anybody at the Smithsonian and I'm not going to cold call the Smithsonian. Cold calling means going where you don't have any connections and nobody knows you. So I wouldn't do that. But this person said, well, here, go to this. There was a Ghanaian owned African clothing store in Adams Morgan. And So I went to it one day, and I was supposed to have an appointment to meet with the owner to show him. Most of my necklaces in the beginning looked very African. They had, were a mix of gemstones and African trade beads. They were beautiful. And so I went, and the owner had forgotten the appointment, and so he wasn't there. He and his wife had gone to New York to shop for the shop, for the store. So I said to the man behind the counter, I said, look, would you mind looking at my pieces and tell him what you thought of them? Because he said he was his best friend. I said, will you tell him what you think of them and ask him to then let me know when I call whether or not he's interested in seeing any more of my work? And he said, okay. So I laid the pieces out and he looked at them and he said, your work is really good. Have you thought about the Smithsonian? And I said, I don't know anybody and I'm not gonna cold call. And he said, well, what if you had a connection with the African Arts gift shop? Would that work for you, like the manager? I said, yeah, that would work. He said, well, that's who I am. So if you take this name and get in touch with the buyers and they will see you. And I worked with them for 5 years and sold to 5 of the different museum shops.
Awesome, wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to be mindful of our time, of your time. We have time for maybe one more question of someone. Oh, there's also comments. This weekend is the Baltimore Bead Society annual show, January 15th through 16th at the Howard County Fairgrounds.
That's definitely something you should go to. It's a wonderful, wonderful bead show.
Yeah. Okay.
Lisa.
Hi, Camilla.
You. This was, again, a wonderful, wonderful program. Elaine, I love your work. And Lisa, good programming.
Thank you.
One of your listeners or participants tonight is Donna Threadgill. She's the president of the Bead Society. I don't know if she'll say anything for Baltimore, Maryland.
Absolutely. Maryland.
Are you there? So I know she enjoyed the show as well.
Yeah, good job. I did. I really did enjoy it. And Camilla, I'm not the president of it. I'm the coordinator for outreach.
Okay. Well, for me, you will always be president. Yeah.
So tell us a little more about the bead bazaar you have coming up.
This is our 14th annual bead show. So we have a lot of the vendors that they come from all over. We usually have Atlantic Jim, so I hope he's going to be there this year.
Oh, he probably will be. You guys do an outstanding job. I'm just highly impressed. We've done some things together in the past when I was president of the Bead Society of Greater Washington. You're an amazing group. Amazing.
Well, everybody has to come and join us. We always like to have people joining, Camilla. We like to have people come.
I heard you.
Yes, yes. So we're looking forward. Hopefully everybody can make it. Don't let the weather stop you, because I'm pretty sure it's not going to snow. And if it does, it's just a little bit. But we'll be there waiting for you. And we have some good demonstrations and some good classes also.
Good.
So
good.
If anybody who's interested, please come out.
One of the things that I wanted to mention is that I do teach private classes as well as groups and so on. So if there's an interest, I'm sure you have the website information, and I'm not looking at the chat, so I don't know what else Denise put in there, but I know she's thorough. So feel free to get in touch. Most classes are 2 hours long, sorry. They generally run a little bit over depending upon what we're working on, but the idea is to take each individual to the height that they can acquire based on their skill level and improve that. So
we'll look forward to having you there. We will coordinate with you and get these classes together.
Love to do that.
Your website is in there, Elaine. Did you want your email?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Denise. There's nothing like brilliant women who back you up, you know? It's just an amazing opportunity to work with folks. Are there any other questions?
Well, yeah, maybe one final question.
Okay.
And then, I mean, there were so many questions, but I know people are trying to be respectful of the time. We could just go on and on talking about beads. They're such a wonderful thing to lift our spirits during this,
they are,
you know, the winter gloom of, so you make me want to get back into, I took some bead stringing classes myself. So
it's a fun thing to do. The piece I'm wearing is spinel, which is one of my favorite stones. And the clasp on this, this is an unusual clasp because it just clasped the, I'm not going to try clasping it. But this is a fun piece and it sparkles in a pitch black room. It sparkles.
Oh, wow.
This is a more cutting edge piece.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll show you. And this closure is with magnets. Not only is it interesting, but I have my magnets, because I do a lot of pieces with magnets, I have a signature magnet that goes on each of my pieces, so it has my initial in it. So even my magnet pieces are signed. So
that's so cool. Yeah, I could see the ladies on Star Trek wearing that one, Elaine.
it's
knowing that you're a Trekkie.
Yeah, absolutely. this stone is called Flint Stone, but it's actually the name of the stone is called Flint Stone, but it's not to be confused with how to start a fire, okay?
or our favorite cartoon characters from our childhood. I could see Wilma sporting that one too, proudly. So this has been fantastic. We're getting all kinds of awesome comments in the chat that I'd encourage you to read. I'm going to save the chat myself because there's so many comments, singing your praises. So many people here loved the program, and many of them are also jewelry artists. So we're so happy to have so many talented folks joining us, and just curious folks. Our SSTCI audiences just have a love of what's going on in the world, and just knowing about our creativity within our community. It's just so rich. We're so fortunate. Yes. So thank you so much, Elaine. It's been a delight, and we can't wait to have you back on our Women in the Arts panel on March 8th, and then we'll be featuring you for your book talk later in the spring.
looking
it'll forward. Be great. And folks can find this on our SSTCI's group Facebook page, or you can email me if you want a link to that if you can't find it. So thank you so much again, Elaine, for a wonderful program, and Happy New Year to everyone.
Oh, thank you all, and it's been a delight.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll see you again next